sky. It's becoming a very, very bright red. Almost an orange. A red orange. And it's like I'm suspended.
You want me to just be totally natural or what?
The great Ring Pi on it.
Done when the bars closed in Chicago, and I was there with Stan Kenton's band, and I was rooming with someone, and he was using heroin. You know, I knew that I would become hooked if I ever tried it, and I don't know, I guess it was just, I just gave up. I guess my wife wasn't on the road with me, and she was at home with Patricia, you know, my daughter, and I had this real strong sexual drive, and so I said, okay, so I sniffed it, you know. This girl came in the bathroom and locked the door, and she just ran the whole thing down to me. And when I, after I sniffed it, she says, look at yourself in the mirror. And I looked at myself in the mirror, and I saw my pupils, like, go from big to just tiny pinpoints, and the feeling was just, it was so beautiful. And she rubbed up against me and, you know, started, like, fondling me. And I said, boy, if this is what the devil's got, man, that's what I want. You know? And that was the beginning and the end. You know? From that minute on, I was hooked. You know?
I met Art, he came up to me and he said, what's your name? I told him my name. I said, what's yours? And he said, I'm Art. As if he thought I would know who he was already. And as I stood there looking blankly at him, he said, Art Pepper. Like, you know, big deal.
I saw Laurie and I thought she was like, I saw her from across the aisle in the bus, and I thought she was purposely you know, changing her leg from one side to the other. She
he
had
still
little,
thinks I was.
Yeah. She had real cute purple panties, you know. And they were just, I was sure that that's what she, I was thinking, boy, she sure is cool, you know. She acts like she's not even doing anything.
When he finally did approach me, I didn't know who he was or what he wanted. He had this look on his face that I think he thought was sexy. He was terrifying. I thought he wanted to rob me. I didn't know what he wanted.
She saved my life, you know. I never thought I could stop using heroin, and I have no marks. I don't use heroin, and I'm playing better than I ever played before. I'm making as much money as a jazz player can make. And she did the thing with the book, our autobiography, everything that we've done. She gets royalties from records that I didn't even know existed.
I took it over because somebody had to do it. All this work of trying to collect royalties on time and establishing our own publishing company, all the things that bring in revenue.
People just used me and used me and used me. All I cared about was if I could get enough money to buy a quarter of heroin so I could shoot it, I'd, you know, yeah, take it. I don't care about royalties, songwriting contracts. As long as I got enough money to buy some heroin, you know, everything would go except my honor. I don't have a sex stand, thank God. If I hadn't got a sex... Baby, I can't find a sex stand. No, I mean, not a stand, the thing.
Strap?
Strap, yeah.
Well, we've got to find the strap.
I know it, but where do we look?
He hit on another girl before he hit on me, and she was a similar type to me, which was this sort of blue stocking, disciplined person who would force him to toe the line. I think that's what he really wanted.
One set, right? I thought that I was like, you know, sort of unique. Because I got so scared, I just got panicked. I would start getting hung up like maybe 3 or 4 days before I had to play.
Just give him your best stuff and leave him wanting more.
Right.
You always play too much.
I would get sick, actually sick of my stomach, yeah. And the only way that I could handle it was getting loaded. It's like you're gonna really do something different. It's really scary, you know. And if you're not scared, it means that you're not really planning on doing anything different.
What?
Like every time I play now, it's like it might be the last time I play, and which isn't being melodramatic. It's just true. When you get to be my age, things happen. You know. Music is the only thing that I really have now. The reason I'm playing music is to communicate. It's like a form of expression, like making noises, you know, like if I could make noise, if I could like growl or laugh or things like that, it would probably serve the same purpose. Challenge. Whenever I play, it's like I don't just play it to play. I would do everything that I could possibly do to try to reach them. severest and best critic. She has a phenomenal feel for what happens, for the way I play. Sometimes it happens, and I think, wow, God, I did it, you know. And the guys in the band, I'll look at them, and they, like, nod their head, you know, and that's, like, that's the ultimate thing, is when the guys in the band really, you know, they look at you, and you can see that you know that they heard what you did. States so that he can be free to play jazz. He's a very complex person. I can't really figure him out. The more I play with him, the more difficult it becomes to figure him out. But he can do incredible things. And he's like me, he wants to be accepted, but he's more obvious about it. I mean, he jumps into an almost impossible technical type thing. And if they don't clap or holler right at that moment, the only thing he can do, I think, is burn the piano, you know, like that. He's not strong enough to break one of those things apart with his fist, you know. But maybe a hand grenade, you know, just drop one in the... just blow it to bits. Makes a group sound like a group, you know, rather than just a jam session. He's very in tune with me. We play together so much that he listens like I do. He's someone that I can go to and talk to about the band and tell him my feelings, you know, and without worrying if he'll get offended or something. A lot. He sort of reminds me of Lil Abner. When I really play well, you can really feel, you know, the communication. But he's very closed off, you know. It's hard. I've never ever reached him. He looks upon me as a different entity altogether. There's a lot of parallels in being a criminal and being a jazz musician. Bob, he's careful. He's always there, you know, so it keeps us from going insane, you know. He's like the guy that is cruel, that would carry the gun in a robbery if he only had one gun, because he would be the one least likely to use it. But with me, I would use it the second that anything went wrong, you know, and love using it. So would Milcho. If the two of us went on a robbery and we had guns, it would really be a violent robbery. I mean, really violent, you know, because we're both filled with hate, you know. Strange. Hate and beauty are so close. ¶¶ once you win, it's great, like for a few, you know, for a short time after. But then by the time I get my horn up and the people are gone and I stop perspiring, then, you know, I just drop just totally to the bottom. It's just, yeah, I can't even begin to tell you how awful it is.
Well, usually in between the busy times, Art spends like days lying on the bed watching television and polishing his shoes.
People say, why don't you go to New York? You go anywhere but here. Yeah, you know, lose yourself. I don't know, there's just something about where you were born, I guess. It's like a womb, you see. You're searching like something to hide into. And there's no way to hide here, but I hide anyway. That's what the room is. I just sit here. And sometimes I spend all day long just sitting here. The only time I get up is to make coffee or go to the bathroom. When Laurie's gone and I'm totally alone here, then I really feel great, you know. But I wouldn't want to have it that way all the time. When I think of San Pedro, I think of my childhood there. And I think of being real lonely, just totally alone, yeah. Years old, and you know, she wanted to enjoy life, you know. I had heard that she had naturally didn't want a child, and so she tried different ways of not having, you know, so she wouldn't have to have a child. And I was determined, I guess, and out I came, you know. I would come home from school and be waiting outside, you know, really cold and hungry and miserable, you know, and I thought, God, I must really be awful, but no one cares about me, you know. She was my first love, and it was that childish, that maiden heaven love that you only love once. And it was like my dream girl. And finally I realized that all I cared for her, well, I just liked her body. She had a nice body and she was passionate. Outside of that, we had nothing in common at all. This is, we were like as different as, you know, it's like squash and pool, you know. East LA is the place where I did most of my stealing and boosting and hustling. To me, this is dope. Everything I see is like, I've fixed in that bathroom, I've stashed here, I've waited for a guy there, I've boosted, pulled burglaries, we pulled an armed robbery, you know. And it's just like exciting, and I think, God, I'd love to get high. If you're fixing good heroin, there's nothing like it. It's like finding the thing at the end of the rainbow, or like finding God, or finding love. There's like a warmth that hits you in the stomach, at least it always did to me, and the stomach would just, you know, just like lay down. It's like laying in a beautiful meadow someplace, and that would go to the rest of your body, and you'd say, oh, you know, it's just, it solves everything. There's no worry about sex, no worry about nothing. It's just marvelous. But the dues are so bad, you know, that anybody that uses it is really crazy, because they're going to go through such agony, you know. I still have dreams about it. Hollywood was great. From the moment I got up until I fell out again was spent in getting high. Well, I was always the one that was able to do the most. It was like a badge of honor, you know. At first, I never thought that I would ever get a tattoo because I didn't want to be marked like that. But then after I went to San Quentin, I said, I must be a criminal, so I'll have some tattoos done. This was the first one, Pan, and he plays music, you know, and he would enter a village, and all the women would follow him. He would lead them off someplace, and the men would hear, like, people laughing and screaming and howls of delight. They would hear the horn the next day, and he was, you know, going away, and the women were never heard of again. And so I figured that was kind of a groovy little thing to have. When I first met her, I thought that she was well and I was sick. I did everything I could to keep her from getting hung up with me because I didn't love her, and I felt guilty until I realized that she just wanted to get messed up, and she sure did. Evidently, she said that she'd been to the emergency receiving hospital in San Francisco and saw a psychologist or something, and he said either join him or leave him, you know. So she decided to join me, yeah. And from then on, like, it was just her thing with heroin. I had nothing to do with her until finally I had to take care of her, you know. She never had to do the things that women have to do, like become whores or deal drugs. Did nothing but lay down and work crossword puzzles while I went out and got money and scored and came home and told her to stick her arm out.
I heard about Art all the time. He was notorious evil dope fiend. And there was this girl that would come over every now and then and cry on Les McCann's shoulder because she was in love with Art and he didn't love her and he was using her and breaking her heart. And so that was the image I had of him, as this heartbreaker, dope fiend, all that stuff. And it was all true.
Next one I got was this, you know, like everything is an act. Then this one, that was the final commitment, the death thing, you know, born to lose, you know, all that bullshit. And I had a vampire drawn up. It was going to be right here, and his fangs were going to be here with red, like blood dripping off his fangs. And as you can see, this is where I used to fix a lot. And I would, like, you know, have a vampire to fix, you know, like a routine. I got to feed my friend, you know. It's like, shows you how ridiculously corny you have to get in order to survive in prison, or to survive anywhere, you know. The first time I got arrested by an informer, they told him that if he could set somebody up for them, they'd cut him loose. And so he just told them about me, and I got busted, you know. Lay in the county jail on the cement floor with the, you know, with the bars and, you know, just in agony, just shaking and vomiting bile and having wet dreams, you know. It's just like it's the most horrible feeling in the world. It's like a nightmare, and you're there, and I used to pray, you know, God, why isn't there someplace that I can go, anything that I can do, you know, that someone that can help me, a doctor, you know. Instead of a doctor, I'm in a cell, you know, that's just, you know, violent. It's just really terrifying. I went one time 14 months without hearing one note of music, not one sound of music. Prison. I could actually see the street that I lived on as a kid, and because it was up on a hill in San Pedro, and Terminal Island was just across the bay. I would be laying in bed, and I would think, oh, God. It seemed like I hadn't left. One day I had a visit, and I looked, and here's Patty, my first wife, and this little girl, you know. And I couldn't figure out who she was, except she looked just like me, only she was a girl. And I said, that must be my daughter. And that's who it was, you know. And I looked at Patty and I says, oh, it's really great to bring Patricia here, you know, with all these groovy cats. You know. She was telling Patricia, Patty, that, you know, the people here are really out of it. You know, they're really outside. They're, you know, no telling what they might have done. People kill people, armed robberies, and, you know, rape, and, you know, rape with violence. And I didn't even realize what was happening at the time. She was, like, setting me up, like, to tell my daughter that I was an animal. I just tried to write a song that would show the way I felt about her, hoping that I could become close to a daughter. Very deep feeling, and I get very sad. Sometimes I get angry. Sometimes I get happy. Like the beginning is real romantic and beautiful, like a dream daughter. Try to forget everything that's happened from that moment to this moment. The fact that we have no contact whatsoever, and there's so many things have happened that there's no way that there's ever going to be any contact. It just made me feel bad that Patty was able to premeditate, you know, the thing of taking the daughter away from me and have her adopted by this guy that had a lot of money and still has a lot of money. And it was like to take Patricia into this prison, and he's a fiend, you know, like, you know, he can't be, you can't be alone with him. He might molest you or something. I mean, you know, it just, and that was like a way to prove it, like, see? Did you see him? Did you see all those animals in there? It took all this time until just recently, until I ever saw Patricia. She's in her 30s and with two kids, you know, and I had never seen her since she was 12, you know, and she lives right down the street. I called her up to wish her Merry Christmas this last Christmas, and she said that she had just read the book. I didn't even know she had heard about it, and she ended up calling me a rapist and a racist. And I said, if that's what you got out of the book, then you're so stupid that I don't ever want to talk to you again, and I hung up, and that was it. To say something about frustration and love and disappointment and like being sorry that the person is not like me and that that they don't understand and they can't realize what's happening with me. And so all I can do is like just blow into the saxophone and try to rid myself of those feelings. My enthusiasm for life and my love for myself, my love of life, my love of music, love of being happy, love of experiencing things that are just beyond description. The blues. It's a thing that you feel when you're sad, you know, and you can cry, and then you feel great while you're doing it. It makes things bearable. It sustains you when you feel that you just ain't gonna be able to do it no more. You just can't stand it. The only way you can stand it is to have something to help you, like a buffer. The buffer is the blues. reach the point where I can be completely honest, where I do what I want to do, you know, and I know it's right, and that's me. And if it ain't right for someone, then they don't know what to listen for, you know. Sometimes I listen to myself playing, I just feel like I'm outside of my body looking at a person playing. I just love myself when that happens, you know. I just feel like a god or something. I'm a prince, I'm a king, you know, I'm like all powerful. My life has been a thing of beauty. This is, I'm a man, I've faced everything, I can face anything, I'll fight anybody, I'll protect my wife, I'll kill, I'll do anything I have to do, because I know I'm right, I'm good, I'm a genius. You know, I'm a genius. I can't think of anybody that plays any better than I do. I've been thinking about trying to get a tattoo for the, you know, like a doctor's mutilating your body, you know. And this is like the mutilation of all mutilations. That was like to repair. I had exploratory surgery, a busted spleen, and then a ventral hernia, and they operated on the ventral hernia and did a great job, as you can see. Yeah.
The first time he took his clothes off in front of me, he almost didn't take his undershirt off. When he takes a shower, very often he will do it with the bathroom lights off. I think it's probably a result of having been so perfect and beautiful and having values that, you know, that was like very, very important. It devastates him. It devastates him all the time. It's not that noticeable to anybody else, but to him it's like an ultimate mutilation.
I have such an ego. I had such an ego, you know, that, you know, beauty was everything to me. And when this happened, I almost like lost my mind. I really did, because it looked so horrible. And for a long time, I would never look at myself in the mirror. It's so ugly, the belly button is gone. This was done at the Veterans Hospital. The first one was done at St. Luke's in San Francisco. And that was like a changing point in my life. Mm-hmm. Ordinarily, I would have used that as an excuse to really go crazy, you know, really get hooked. Oh, these are the Pittsburgh Steelers. I love the Steelers. I love pro football. Here I've been a dope fiend, an alcoholic. It just mutilated my body. Heroin, alcohol, cigarettes, sweets. I think sweets is the hardest one of all. Yeah. I haven't been able to control that one yet.
Sometimes I think that I'm the one that's strange, that I just don't understand things the way the rest of the world does. But I don't see him as a tragic or an evil character at all. I see him as an extremely amusing and interesting person with a tremendous amount of nerve and courage and a great deal of humor.
Laurie. Yeah. She has done everything that I said that everybody else did for me, and I feel like a hypocrite saying it, but she's the real thing. I love her. I finally found out what love is. It's like a caring and a being comfortable, a friend, someone that will tell you when you do good, when you do bad.
I love it when he writes songs about me. I got to admit that. I count them. I say, oh, that makes six or seven. And it's the ultimate compliment. And they're always great. They're always beautiful songs. I love every single one of them. And the latest one, our song, which is really, he wrote it for both of us. That's the best of all.
This entrance is like, you know, it says the whole thing. It's the way I feel, and the way I feel about Laurie. It's like the most subtle hello, like, you know, and a feeling of love. This is really beautiful. Through all these things that I guess I had to go through, and I survived.